that you are here with us this morning. We welcome all who are joining us from your home. We are so pleased that you are with us in spirit. We ask that cell phones be silenced. Today, we are celebrating the first Sunday of Advent. I am Audrey Wilson. Our second lector is now. Leader of song is Juliana Rifkin. Monsignor Michael McGee is the principal celebrant. Next weekend, there will be a second collection for both the retirement fund for religious and the Christmas flowers and church decorations. Due to a delay in receiving our new prayer books, we will only be using the current blue-covered prayer books for the hymns. The Christmas giving trees are available on the sides of the church so that our parishioners may assist the less fortunate at Christmas time. Please take a tag today. Gifts can be returned and placed around the Christmas trees until noontime on Sunday, December the 13th. Please be mindful that when returning the gift, to please use the original tag so as to identify the gift for the proper family. Thank you very much. We greatly appreciate everyone quietly putting their kneeler down on leaving church today. Thank you. The Pot of Gold jackpot prize is $87,000. The next drawing will be on Monday evening at 7 p.m. Tickets are available in the vestibule of the church and also at the rectory. As the number of tickets being sold increases, volunteers are needed to assist with the drawing. If you are interested in assisting us, please come to the gym at 6:30 on Monday evening. No experience or long-term commitments are necessary. Thank you. Please stand. And let us pray the prayer for priestly vocations. Father, in your plan for salvation, you provide shepherds for your people. Fill your church with the spirit of courage and love. Raise up worthy ministers for your altars and ardent but gentle servants of the gospel. Bless our archdiocese with numerous vocations to the sacred priesthood. Grant this through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. Amen.
Our entrance hymn is number 39, Come Thou Long Expected Jesus, 3-9.
The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. We celebrate today the first Sunday of Advent and call to mind our Lord's coming among us as a baby, his coming in hidden ways among us, his coming at the end of time for those who will receive him to still the desires, to fulfill the desires of every human heart. Brothers and sisters, let's acknowledge our sins and so prepare ourselves to celebrate the sacred mysteries. I confess to Almighty God and to you, my brothers and sisters, that I have greatly sinned in my thoughts and in my words, in what I've done and in what I've failed to do, through my most grievous fault. Therefore, I ask Blessed Mary, Ever Virgin, all the angels and saints, and you, my brothers and sisters, to pray for me to the Lord our God. May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to everlasting life. So that gathered at his right hand, they may be worthy to possess the heavenly kingdom. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God forever and ever.
Amen.
A reading from the book of the prophet Isaiah. You, Lord, are our Father, our Redeemer, you are named forever. Why do you let us wander, O Lord, from your ways, and harden our hearts so that we fear you not? Return for the sake of your servants, the tribes of your heritage. Oh, that you would rend the heavens and come down, with the mountains quaking before you, while you wrought awesome deeds we could not hope for, such as they had not heard of from of old. No ear has ever heard, no eye ever seen, any God but you doing such deeds for those who wait for him. Would that you might meet us doing right, that we were mindful of you in our ways. Behold, you are angry and we are sinful. All of us have become like unclean people. All our good deeds are like polluted rags. We have all withered like leaves, and our guilt carries us away like the wind. There is none who calls upon your name, who rouses himself to cling to you. For you have hidden your face from us and have delivered us up to our guilt. Yet, O Lord, You are our Father. We are the clay, and you the potter. We are all the work of your hands. The word of the Lord.
A reading from the first letter of St. Paul to the Corinthians. Brothers and sisters, grace to you and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. I give thanks to my God always on your account for the grace of God bestowed on you in Christ Jesus, that in him you were enriched in every way, with all discourse and all knowledge, as the testimony to Christ was confirmed among you, so that you are not lacking in any spiritual gift as you wait for the revelation of our Lord Jesus Christ. He will keep you firm to the end, irreproachable on the day of our Lord Jesus Christ. God is faithful, and by him you were called to fellowship with his Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. The word of the Lord.
From the Holy Gospel according to Mark. Jesus said to his disciples, "Be watchful, be alert. You do not know when the time will come. It is like a man traveling abroad. He leaves home and places his servants in charge, each with his own work, and orders the gatekeeper to be on the watch. Watch, therefore. You do not know when the Lord of the house is coming, whether in the evening or at midnight or at cockcrow or in the morning. May he not come suddenly and find you sleeping. What I say to you, I say to all. Watch." The Gospel of the Lord. Today we begin a new year of the church's calendar with the words of Jesus urging us to be on the lookout constantly for his return. Since we don't know when he'll come again to take us to himself, we have to be ready and alert at every moment so that we won't be unprepared for it. At first glance, it might seem like an impossible task. It's been 2,000 years since our Lord spoke these words. And it's hard for anybody to stay on guard even for a few hours, much less for a whole lifetime, for an event that was promised more than 20 lifetimes ago. But then the coming of Jesus is an event that's like no other. Jesus is really talking about a readiness, not just for some external event, even though at the end of time, his coming will be something that affects us all, whether we're thinking about it or not. But instead, we're talking here about being ready for something that our hearts are already secretly longing for at every moment, even if we might be trying to run away from it. So many people in notable quotes have described human life itself as a search for something. I put the phrase, "life is a search for," into an internet search, and a number of different things came up. Life is a search for happiness, according to some. And another said, "life is a search for truth." And still another said, "life is a search for beauty." And in America, it seems like a common opinion might be, "life is a search for success."
So when Jesus tells his disciples always to be on the lookout and to keep in watch in search of his coming, he's saying that with a deep awareness of what's in the human heart. He knows that by virtue of the very nature that his heavenly Father put in us, we're searchers. He just wants us to be alert and searching for the right thing, not for the wrong things or in the wrong way. So if we consider all those things, happiness, truth, beauty, success, which is really the right one to keep our focus on? The Austrian psychiatrist Viktor Frankl, who survived a Nazi concentration camp and lived another 50 years, died in 1997. Shortly after World War II, he wrote a book based on that experience in the concentration camp and published it in English, or the translation into English was published under the title Man's Search for Meaning. And he learned from that experience of the concentration camp that a lot of times we live our lives searching for the wrong things, with the result that we lose the happiness that we are meant to have. He wrote, and I quote him here, "Don't aim at success. The more you aim at it and make it a target, the more you're going to miss it. For success, like happiness, cannot be pursued. It must ensue. And it does so only as the unintended side effect of one's personal dedication to a cause greater than oneself, or as the byproduct of one's surrender to a person other than oneself." Even though Dr. Frankl was not a Christian, he was a Jew. That's why he was suffered in the prison camp under the Nazis. But I think he actually discovered through that suffering in the concentration camp a yearning in his own heart for the very thing that Jesus is telling us he is the one who's come to fill, that cause greater than ourselves that he wants us to devote our lives to, that person other than ourselves that we surrender to in order to find true happiness. But Jesus actually says something more besides that. He tells this parable of a man who goes on a trip and tells the gatekeeper of his house, "Keep watch." And then he turns to us and says, "You keep watch." In other words, each of us is a gatekeeper. Now, it's not the job of a gatekeeper to leave his post and go searching high and low for anything, anywhere. It's the job of the gatekeeper to stay at the door and wait for the one who says he is coming. That happiness, that truth, that beauty, that wellspring of all meaning that our hearts are instinctively searching for has come knocking at our door and will keep knocking at our door until we let him in. And his name is Jesus. In fact, he's knocking on our door every single day. His words are speaking to us in every page of the scriptures, in every sacrament, every teaching of his church that speaks to us of God's love and of his plan for us, a plan that's his, not a plan of our own making. We just have to listen to his call. He's knocking at our door in every decision that we're called to make from day to day that involves a choice between right and wrong. When he asks us to think not just of our urges or appetites, but of what's the will of our Father in heaven, that's the only thing that'll really bring us peace. He's knocking at our door every time there's a person in front of us, family, friend, or stranger, that he is calling on us to love. As he says, "Whatever you did to the least of these, my brothers and sisters, you did to me." If we keep opening the door to him each time when he knocks, in those ways, we'll have prepared ourselves to be open to him that last time when he comes again for us. We'll be opening the door to the one who's been in our company in all these ways and become a familiar friend. But besides the one who comes only to give us perfect happiness, God's word tells us that there is also an enemy who brings nothing but distractions, and opening the door to that enemy is liable to keep us from being ready for the coming of the one who brings us happiness. That enemy knocks at our door to tell us we can't be happy unless we have X, Y, or Z. That we need to agree, contrary to God's will, we need to agree to A, B, or C so that people's opinion of us will be good. He often knocks and fills our ears with the sounds of resentments and regrets because the world is a bad place, or because our country is fatally flawed and supposedly has to be destroyed and started all over again, or that this or that person is evil and has to be despised and dehumanized. Any of those voices at the door that fill our ears or minds with hatred or envy or malice not only put us at odds with our Savior, they keep us from hearing him when he knocks at the door. To protect ourselves from that, we need to be on guard. We need to be sure that each and every day it's his knock that we're waiting for at the door of our hearts, that it's his voice that we're listening to over and above any others. That if he's not the one that we're looking for, waiting for, then we're likely to miss him when he appears. So today we thank the Lord for his coming among us in Bethlehem 2,000 years ago, and in word and sacrament right now. And as we look for his presence in the people and in the events that surround us, and especially whenever it might seem that he's not answering our prayers or letting things happen that seem to come more from the powers of evil than from him, we need to be patient. To be confident that he has a plan, not only for each one of us, but for the whole world. That if he lets things happen that drive us into his arms, that going into his arms is actually better for us than if those things had not happened. He's able to use every single thing that happens, including disasters, including our own failings and sins, as long as we repent. He's able to use them as a way to bring us closer to him and make us his forever. So we trust him, and we ask him for the grace to stay always on the lookout for the next message that he sends us beneath, hidden beneath the surface of the people, places, and things that we encounter each day. And when he's the one we keep looking for sincerely in everything, we have every reason to be confident that when he comes on that last day, either for any one of us who leaves this world in death, or when he comes to us all together on the last day of history, we'll be looking into the face that tells us with no uncertainty at all, I am the one you've been seeking. You did well to seek me instead of some other happiness or truth or beauty or success. Because you sought me instead of those, come into my kingdom and receive all of this from my heavenly Father now. Infinite happiness, untarnished truth, perfect beauty, and the eternal reward of a life that's well lived. And I promise to you that everyone who seeks me will find me, and you sought me above everything else. So here I am to bring you home.
I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all things visible and invisible. I believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, born of the Father before all ages, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, consubstantial with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us men and for our salvation, he came down from heaven. And by the Holy Spirit was incarnate of the Virgin Mary and became man. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried and rose again on the third day in accordance with the scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and Son is adored and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. I believe in one holy, Catholic, and apostolic church. I confess one baptism for the forgiveness of sins, and I look forward to the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. We begin this season of Advent with trust in God's love for us. So let's present him with our needs and the needs of our world.
For the church, may the Lord look graciously upon us as we proclaim the gospel message. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For civic leaders, may Christ strengthen their conviction as servant leaders for all people. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For our family members and loved ones who struggle with mental illness, may God bring them healing and peace. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For St. Charles Seminary, as they continue their annual appeal, may the seminarians, faculty, and administrators know the support of our parishioners. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear
our prayer. For our parish community, as we continue with the Next Generation Catholic Parish Initiative, may the Holy Spirit guide us as we establish our envisioning committee and soon begin to develop a parish pastoral plan. Let us pray to the Lord. For an increase in vocations to the priesthood and religious life, especially from among our St. Francis Cabrini Parish, may those who are called respond with confidence and joy. Let us pray to the Lord. For police officers, that they may be respected and that they, along with firefighters, first responders, military personnel, and those on the front line of the coronavirus pandemic may be protected from harm as they strive to serve others, and for all veterans who have served our country and thus maintained our freedom as a nation. Let us pray to the Lord. For the sick of our community and all those who've requested our prayers, including those reflected in the White Intercessory Book, may they be comforted by the caregiving and compassion of others. We especially pray for Nick Alvino Sr., Loretta Arant, Bob Batten, El Caruso, Nicholas Corrado, Bob Evich, Mark Gravante, Patrick Galloway, John Haney, Dorothy Harris, Tom Holden, Will Hottenstein, Shirley Kasparidis, Janet Law, Connor Scott Moll, Meg McFadden, Danica Maholland, Locke Wynn, John O'Callaghan, Carmela Olimpo, Jeff Rodunda, Nick Stetz, Lindsay Sturkey, Bob Sokowski, Mary Jane Vitimo, and Kathleen Coolin. Let us pray to the Lord. For all who have died, especially our loved ones, may God bring them home to be with him forever. As we especially pray for Barbara Cleveland, Joseph Dolan, Florence Harkinson, Richard Kozlowski, Carolyn Pace, Mike Raniola, Regina Robinson, Ken Steele, Joseph Stefanik, Lee Ann Stetson, Christian Vallon, and all those who have died as a result of violence and the coronavirus pandemic. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer. God, our Father, hear these prayers of your people and grant them according to your holy will. Through Christ our Lord.
Our offertory hymn is number 68, Maranatha, 6-8.
Pray, brothers and sisters, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father.
May the Lord accept the sacrifice at your hands for the praise and glory of his name, for our good and all of his holy church.
Accept, we pray, O Lord, these offerings we make, gathered from among your gifts to us, and may what you grant us to celebrate devoutly here below gain for us the prize of eternal redemption. Through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right and just.
It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks. Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God, through Christ our Lord. For he assumed at his first coming the lowliness of human flesh, and so fulfilled the desire you formed long ago, and opened for us the way to eternal salvation, that when he comes again in glory and majesty, and all is at last made manifest, we who watch for that day may inherit the great promise in which we dare to hope. And so, with angels and archangels, with thrones and dominions, and with all the hosts and powers of heaven, we sing the hymn of your glory, as without end we acclaim. To you, therefore, most merciful Father, we make humble prayer and petition through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, that you accept and bless these gifts, these offerings, these holy and unblemished sacrifices, which we offer you firstly for your holy Catholic Church. Be pleased to grant her peace, to guard, unite, and govern her throughout the whole world, together with your servant Francis, our Pope, and Nelson, our Bishop, his assistant bishops, and all those who, holding to the truth, hand on the Catholic and Apostolic faith. Remember, Lord, your servants, and all gathered here whose faith and devotion are known to you. For them we offer you this sacrifice of praise, or they offer it for themselves and all who are dear to them, for the redemption of their souls in hope of health and well-being, and paying their homage to you, the eternal God, living and true, in communion with those whose memory we venerate, especially the glorious ever-Virgin Mary, Mother of our God and Lord Jesus Christ, and Blessed Joseph, her spouse, your blessed apostles and martyrs, Peter and Paul, Andrew, James, John, Thomas, James, Philip, Bartholomew, Matthew, Simon, and Jude, Linus, Cletus, Clement, Sixtus, Cornelius, Cyprian, Lawrence, Chrysogonus, John and Paul, Cosmas and Damian, and all your saints. We ask that through their merits and prayers in all things we may be defended by your protecting help. Therefore, Lord, we pray, graciously accept this oblation of our service, that of your whole family. Order our days in your peace, and command that we be delivered from eternal damnation and counted among the flock of those you've chosen. Be pleased, O God, we pray, to bless, acknowledge, and approve this offering in every respect. Make it spiritual and acceptable, so that it may become for us the body and blood of your most beloved Son, our Lord Jesus Christ. On the day before he was to suffer, he took bread in his holy and venerable hands,
And with eyes raised to heaven, to you, O God, his almighty Father, giving you thanks, he said the blessing, broke the bread, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took this precious chalice in his holy and venerable hands, and once more giving you thanks, he said the blessing and gave the chalice to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me."
The mystery of faith.
When we eat this bread and drink this cup, we proclaim your death, O Lord, until you come again.
Blessed Passion, the resurrection from the dead, and the glorious ascension into heaven of Christ, your Son, our Lord. We, your servants and your holy people, offer to your glorious majesty from the gifts that you have given us, this pure victim, this holy victim, this spotless victim, the holy bread of eternal life and the chalice of everlasting salvation. Be pleased to look upon these offerings with a serene and kindly countenance, and to accept them as once you were pleased to accept the gifts of your servant Abel the just, the sacrifice of Abraham our father in faith, and the offering of your high priest Melchizedek, a holy sacrifice, a spotless victim. In humble prayer, we ask you, Almighty God, command that these gifts be borne by the hands of your holy angel to your altar on high in the sight of your divine majesty, so that all of us who through this participation at the altar receive the most holy body and blood of your Son, may be filled with every grace and heavenly blessing. Remember also, Lord, your servants who have gone before us with a sign of faith and rest in the sleep of peace. Grant them, O Lord, we pray, and all who sleep in Christ, a place of refreshment, light, and peace. To us also, your servants, who though sinners hope in your abundant mercies, graciously grant some share in fellowship with your holy apostles and martyrs, with John the Baptist, Stephen, Matthias, Barnabas, Ignatius, Alexander, Marcellinus, Peter, Felicity, Perpetua, Agatha, Lucy, Agnes, Cecilia, Anastasia, and all your saints. Admit us, we beseech you, into their company, not weighing our merits, but granting us your pardon through Christ our Lord. Through whom you continue to make all these good things, O Lord. You sanctify them, fill them with life, bless them, and bestow them upon us.
Through him and with him and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever.
At the Savior's command, Informed by divine teaching, we dare to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ. Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, Peace I leave you, my peace I give you, look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever. The peace of the Lord be with you always. Behold the Lamb of God. Behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb.
Since some of us are not able to physically receive Holy Communion, please join us in praying the act of spiritual communion. Let us pray. My Jesus, I believe that you are present in the most holy sacrament. I love you above all things, and I desire to receive you into my soul. Since I cannot at this moment receive you sacramentally, come at least spiritually into my heart. I embrace you as if you were already there, and unite myself wholly to you. Never permit me to be separated from you. Amen. Our communion hymn will be 587, Christ Be Our Light, 587.
Truth, we turn to you. Make us your own.
Let us pray. May these mysteries, O Lord, in which we have participated, profit us, we pray. For even now, as we walk amid passing things, you teach us by them to love the things of heaven and hold fast to what endures. Through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
And may Almighty God bless you, the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Go forth, the Mass is ended.
Thanks be to God.
Saint Michael, the Archangel, defend us in battle.
Be our protection
against the wickedness and snares of the devil. May God rebuke him, we humbly pray. And do thou, O Prince of Heavenly Hosts, by the power of God, cast into hell Satan and all the evil spirits who prowl about the world, seeking the ruin of souls. Amen. Our recessional hymn is number 385, City of God, 385.
Awake from your slumber.